Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now, here's a message from Pastor Jim Cobray.
Now look, tonight we're going to do something a little different. I'm going to share the Word of God. I've been doing this for 40 years, and so I can't say I've learned very much, but I've learned a little bit. And I thought what we'd do is have just a family Bible study. Is that okay? And when I read the Word of God, I read the Word of God so slow, and I'm really grateful for that. I'm really a bad reader, and God took being a bad reader. Anybody a bad reader besides me in the house, you know what I mean? Like, I had a fifth grade reading level when I graduated from high school, and it was, you know, it was really embarrassing to me if I ever had to read aloud to anybody. Many times I'll read the Word of God, and people will come up to me in the back door. I don't like these people. And they say, what translation are you reading from? It's called the translation of memorization half the time, you know. And so I'm a bad reader, but I found that God took my bad reading and made it so fabulous. Because I'm a bad reader, I had to go so slow and think about what I was reading. Isn't that interesting? And it actually took that which was not good and made it something very good for the rest of my life as I taught the Word of God. I consider myself a theologian in the Word of God. I just spend time there. The other day I was chatting with somebody and they knew I was a pastor and they made a statement to me. They said these words that were really quite surprising. They were trying to be nice, but they were criticizing some churches that they had been in. And they were making statements that were just foolish and stupid statements. And I didn't want to argue with them. You ever hear something, you know, you don't want to argue. You don't want to say, well, that's stupid. You shouldn't feel that way. I just shut up and listened. Well, because I was at the dentist and my mouth was full of their hands, I couldn't really say anything anyway. You know what I mean? So I just listened. And I heard all of the little comments about how churches went to this church and it was, they did this, went to this church, they did that, went to this church, they did that, and all the, you know, all the basic silly stuff that people evaluate when they go to a church. Let me tell you something. Forget about evaluating anything. Get into a place that you hear the Word of God in an uncompromised way and stop thinking that you know everything. And how you, the person who was criticizing the church probably hadn't been in church five times in their entire life, yet they knew how a church should be. That's the part that really got me. It's like, could you just take your hands out of my mouth? Because I would really like to say something to you, but they kept their hands in my mouth, you know, and so I didn't say anything. I find that a lot of people want the Word of God the way they think they should have it, instead of the way God wants to present it. You know, don't tell me something in my face that rubs me the wrong way that's irritating. Because if it's irritating, it certainly can't be God. I want you to know something. That's exactly what God's Word does. It irritates your flesh so that you are going to do one of two things. You're either going to run from it or run to it. You're either going to make the change or not make the change. And I'm thrilled at the Rock Church World Outreach Center. Nobody's compromising the Word of God. But even though at times we've got to go, instead of hallelujah, we go, oh my goodness. That really stunned me. That really shocked me. But I guess that's what the Bible says, so I'm going to listen to it. Now, let me tell you something as an old man. Nobody's ever told you anything like this except probably me 1,000 times, but you got to hear me. You have probably in your life looking at the future. For everybody that's in here looking at the future, can I say something? At 70 years old, I have a future too. And it's just as big, and my dreams are just as big and just as wild as they've ever always been. So don't think I got to a certain age and all of a sudden I stopped thinking and I'm not going to do anything. I mean, I have dreams of seeing stuff done for the gospel that is way beyond anything. So every one of us have dreams and visions of the future. God, if you don't do anything about the Word of God, yes, it will rub your flesh the wrong way, but you got to come to one place of realization. And the realization is this. Here's what you got to listen to. Listen. Is that God wants to prosper you. God, listen, God knows how this all works. So many times we think we got the idea, we know how it works, we've got the philosophy, we got the insight, we got the degrees, we've got the education, we've got the money, we've got the track record, we've got the proof, we've got it all. Can I tell you something? You can take all that hooey and throw it out the window. And I was nice saying hooey. And I'm here to tell you something. If you want to know about your future and success of your future, find out what the Word of God says. It will rub you often the wrong way. It'll challenge you. It'll straighten you up. It'll get you to fly right. It'll get you to think differently. But all of a sudden, somewhere along the lines, you're going to find yourself so incredibly blessed. And you have to come to a place of realizing that God did that. Amen. Because I followed Him, God did this. Not because I was smart, not because I was talented, not because I was gifted, not because I fit in with everybody else, not because I looked like everybody else, dressed like everybody else, had an education like everybody else. It had nothing to do with it. We always think those things are going to make us successful. And we work really hard getting those things in order to be successful. Success comes when you and I realize, man, what God says, that's it, settles it, done deal. And now guess what? There's a future now because of what God says. And until you come to that place, I don't care who you are, how long you've been around, you'll be the critic instead of the receiver. And just like that person was a critic of the church, critic of how they did things, critic, you know, when people come in and say, well, you know, critic of the lights of the Rock Church and the smoke. Well, why should the world have all the things? If we're going to glorify God, let's let the smoke out. Let's let the lights out. Let's let the flash out. We got the biggest flash there ever is. His name is Jesus. I mean, come on. If you don't even believe in anything, the Big Bang Theory wasn't a little puff. Man, it was a whole lot more than all these lights, for an example. And when God spoke, bang, it all happened. You know, so come on. Let's just lighten up a little bit. Let God be God tonight. And let Him talk to each and every one of us. Proverbs 3rd chapter. I was reading Proverbs last week. I just sat down. It happened to be the 3rd of June. So I kind of like going through the Proverbs. And then I hit a proverb that lasts for 4 or 5 days. And then I've got to go for 4 or 5 Proverbs to catch up to the date. You know, does anybody do that besides me? It's just kind of a fun, disciplined way of reading the Word of God. Proverbs, there's 31 chapters of thought. Proverbs, oftentimes there's 31 days in the month, so I make sure I meditate at least a proverb every single day, but it happened to be a 3rd Proverbs, and it just, I've read it a billion times. Somehow, here's what happens, I guess, when you get old. God speaks to you so clear about things that is no longer looking for stuff, no longer hoping to hear. It's like He wants to talk so much that I have to turn it off or I would sit there for 8 hours and not do anything. And it's almost a sad situation. Proverbs 3rd chapter, verse 1. I'm going to go through 10 verses tonight prayerfully. We can get through these 10 verses. First 2 words, my son. In fact, the title of the message, I don't even remember what God speaks. Can we put the title up? Then we'll come back to God speaks, Proverbs 3. He speaks, and if He speaks, let's listen. Is that okay? Yeah. And so God's speaking to you and I tonight through Proverbs. I don't give a flip about who wrote it. We all know that. And when it was written and the time period. The Word of God is forever. It's eternal, the Bible says. 2 things eternal. Did you know that? Only 2 things in the Bible. Man's soul and the Word of God. It's only 2 things that are eternal. The church comes along, works on the soul of men, and preaches that which is eternal. Both eternal things church is supposed to do. That's what churches are all about. And He comes along, verse number 1, and He says these words, my son, which just blew me away. The intimacy that God describes from His portion of what goes on. Here's God saying, I see you not as a stranger. I don't see you as a sinner. I don't see you as a loser. I don't see you as uneducated, a fat, lazy slob that has nothing. I see you as my child. And I don't know if you know this or not. Some of you have lousy parental remembrance in your life, and it's hard for you to identify with that. Please stop it. Your earthly parents could be the biggest dirt bags in the world, but your heavenly Father is in a different category by Himself. and should be treated differently. My comes along and he says, my son, what an intimate relationship he, from his perspective, sees you. Oftentimes we don't see him from that intimate perspective, but he sees you and sees me in this intimate perspective. And by the way, I just want to point this out to you. From God's perspective, he is seeing you as his child. Wow. How many times do we go through the day and say, boy, I'm a loser, I'm a failure, I'm no good. Those people left me, and I don't blame them for leaving me. I was never any good. I was a bum. I must have made mistakes. Nobody, I'm just unlovable. Nobody really cares about me. Nobody. I'm uneducated. I don't know what to do. I don't know how to live life. I saw my parents, and they didn't get it. I don't want to be like them. I saw my uncles, my aunts, and they failed. And the people I did business with, they cheated and lied on me. And I'm a no good. I'll never make anything of myself. And here comes God and says, listen, you're my child. But if there's going to be an intimate relationship, there's got to be an intimate relationship, because the only way you can have it is when two people are intimate. You cannot have one person intimate and the other person not intimate. I mean, it'd be like a husband coming along and saying, I love you so much to my wife, I'm positively on board, and I made a commitment, and the wife runs off and is a prostitute or hooking and whoring around the streets or out at night and never faithful. There's no intimacy there at all. Intimacy, my friends, takes two people, and it starts with a proper perspective of who you really, really are. You're not a world throwaway. And if you are, praise God, because you don't want to be in the world anyway. That was actually a good thing, because it finally woke you up enough to get to God. So you may have been a world throwaway. You may have been a family throwaway. Your mom and dad may have thrown you away and didn't give a flip about you at all. Showed you no love whatsoever. But here's the God, the creator of the heavens and the earth, and he's coming along and he's making this statement, my child. My, not somebody else's, not somebody else out there, but my child. Oh my goodness. And if all he's looking for is to have that intimate relationship, which means there has to be of our part of this in order to have that part. And by the way, when our part of intimacy starts to grow and take place, can I tell you something? Then all the blessings of heaven that he wants to give starts to flow your way beyond that which you could possibly ever imagine or think. Not in common place, not in common terms. But this intimate relationship that we're talking about here, that God sees you in, and then you respond with the same kind of an intimate relationship back to God, all of a sudden, the world that you live in changes. Things start to happen. And that's what he starts to express here in this, the word that was so good. My son. And then first thing out of his mouth, he says in this chapter is, do not forget. God, we forget, don't we? We forget about where we came from. We forget about what he did. We forget about how he rescued us. For a lot of us, we forget about, man, we're alive today and we shouldn't even have been alive. We forget those times. We forget always. I mean, we're the most forgetful people and creatures on the planet, would it seem to be. We forget all the time about what he's done. You know, he did something a month ago. He did something 6 months ago. He did something a year ago or 2 or 3 years ago. But today's a new day, we say. I don't remember then, but I forget. First thing God says is, I understand, my child, that you are a forgetful creature on the planet. But if you don't forget, and can I tell you something? Someone says, well, Pastor, how do I not forget? Can I tell you, only I can just give you a simple illustration of how I didn't forget. Can I tell you how? Here's how I didn't forget over the years. If there's anything I did right, I've never forgot. Oftentimes you'll see me sit there and worship in the chair. I remember where I came from, how broken I was. I remember the wives that walked out on me. I didn't know why. With other people.
I remember those days. I remember not having anything and sleeping on the beach because I didn't have a place to live. I remember those areas, and we forget where we come from all the time. And I found simplicity, how not to forget. You want to know what it is? It's a simple word called, are you ready? Church. Church helps me to remember. When I'm in the world and I'm doing, you know, we love to sail, at least we used to love to sail. I haven't sailed so long, I don't know when. I love to sail. When I do all those things, you know, those worldly, carnal things, but there's so much fun, and God lets me do it and lets me enjoy nature and all that kind of stuff. But when I do those things, it doesn't remind me until I get on the front row and I sing a song. We're going forward, not going back. When we sing a song about how dance before the Lord, as David danced, and all of a sudden we stop and we think about, you know, David did something in his life. Remember when he was being exalted and king over all of Israel and Judah, and he's coming up into Jerusalem, and he takes off his robes and he dances, and his wife is just so mad at him because he strips himself. Did you know that he was stripping himself of his kingly robe? What he was really saying is, I'm coming into the position as king over Israel, not because I'm got this robe on, but because I've got God on. And he was making a statement, and those kind of things remind me of what I should be doing and shouldn't be doing, and how I should feel and how I should look and how I should act and how I respond. And I find people that go to church stronger than people that don't go to church. People that don't go to church criticize, but people that go to church are grateful. Do not, he says, forget. I mean, that if there's a commandment there, there's a commandment. And you say, well, how do I do this? How do I do this? Do I put it to memorization? I know people quote scripture to you, but they forget where they came from. Forget the tenderness of God. Forget the mercy of God. Forget the truth of God. You can quote this stuff until you know it off the top of your head. Doesn't mean you're going to live it. And what helps you to live it is the constant reminders that when we gather together, we become stronger in Him. Because we somehow, a song sets something off, or a word sends something off, or something, a thought comes through by the Holy Spirit. And that's the stuff that you and I need to hold on to. That's what happens in church. You don't get that sitting at home watching television about, you know, what's going to take place with this murder mystery and crazy things that are on television and all that stuff. You just don't get the reminder. The reminder comes when you put your pants on and you get to church. Simple as that, my friends. And I want to challenge some of you. You used to come on Wednesday nights. You don't come anymore. You used to come every time you were hungry for God. You were thirsty for God. You don't come anymore. You used to be hungry and thirsty. You're not hungry and thirsty anymore. God is just something you do instead of something you have got to have. There was a time when you had to have it, because you didn't forget how important he was to you. And now he's become something that you do instead of something you have to have. And when you get that way, my friends, because life absorbs you, you will forget. Do not forget my law. You might as well just take the word law there and circle it. You know what it really means? What I'm telling you about myself that you should operate in order for you to be blessed. That's what it is. We're not talking about the Ten Commandments. We're not talking about the Old Testament law. We're talking about what God says to mankind, that if you do it, you get blessed. Don't tell me you don't want to be blessed. Don't tell me that you don't live to be blessed. Don't tell me you didn't go to school to get blessed. Don't tell me you don't go to work 8 hours a day because you like the blessings that comes at the end of the week when you get a check. Don't tell me you don't want to be blessed. You want to be blessed? Here's how to be blessed. Don't forget what God says about life. But you will forget it if you don't know it. And church helps you to get it. Is anybody listening? He says, let. Notice the next word. But let. Option's yours. Let means you can do it or not do it. Your call. Isn't that interesting how God comes along and says, listen, I love you and I call you my child. I want to have an intimate relationship with you. Now it's your call as to whether or not you want to have an intimate relationship with me. If it was God's call, he'd make us all robots to have an intimate relationship with him. But he doesn't. He gives us a free will choice, because that's what he really wants, is somebody who really wants to be with him. And he comes along and he makes the word let. Your heart. Now, when he comes to this place where he says, let your heart, this is a really fascinating thing here. Your heart always wants to go away from the things of God instead of going to the things of God. Oftentimes, I will drive into business situations down in Orange County. I'm on the freeway. I have satellite radio in my car. And instead of listening to something spiritual, I'll just put on a jazz station. And listen to that. And all of a sudden, I just find myself in a place of going that didn't help me, didn't encourage me, didn't do anything. It was just stupid noise music that went in 40 different directions to a certain kind of a beat that didn't really make any sense whatsoever. And I find myself doing something, and my heart, and I have to really work at my heart to get it back to where it needs to be, so it's listening to something that's going to edify and build me up. Because my heart always wants to go away. Your heart doesn't even really want to come to church. Did you know your heart is usually happier when you leave church than when you come to church? For most people, that's the way it is. You have to work at your heart on a constant basis. If you don't work at your heart, then you're not letting your heart. In other words, the word let there is another word that says, come on, make it happen. Make your heart. That's what it's really saying. It's really fascinating. Keep my commandments, because it's in his commandments when you keep them that you get blessed. Someone says, I want to be blessed, Pastor Jim. I really want to live a good life. I want to have a great marriage. I want to be happy all the time. I want to, yes, I know there'll be trials and tribulations. I know the pressures of the devil want to come and knock me off my feet, but I'm here to tell you something. I really want to be blessed. Therefore, I have got to make my heart. When I was sick, I had to make my heart praise God. I did not feel like praising God. Dr. Kanga called me and said, it's time to start praising God. I got up with tears in my face and was screaming from my heart and my voice, and God, I praise you, I praise you. I no more felt like standing and praising God than the man in the moon. From that moment on, God started healing me. And the point being is this, is I had to make my heart do what, if I'm waiting for my heart to do it, it won't do it. Why? Because we all had these corrupted hearts. We were born with sin nature. So therefore, this is a training process. Where do I get my training from? Church. If you're not in a church that's training you in the Word of God, you're in the wrong church. Get out of here and go find someplace else. But if this is your place, let me tell you something, where you're learning and growing, then you ought to fight to get here, because it'll help you to learn how to keep your heart into the things of God. Somebody ought to give me a great big amen, because I'm telling the truth now. See, because I'm sick and tired of people not being blessed. I'm sick and tired of people living in a lukewarm life. Let me tell you something. You can say anything you want to say. You read this book. It's radical. You listen to the words of Jesus, drink my blood and eat my flesh. Oh, my goodness. He's pretty radical. Pick up your cross and follow me. If you're not willing to pick up your cross, he's pretty radical. And you've got preachers nowadays that are really comforting your ears all the time, tweaking you so that you'll come back to church. I feel good about church. Let me tell you something. The Word of God doesn't rub you the wrong way. You haven't got anything. Amen. And I don't care if there's five people here next week. The Word of God's being preached in this place. So let's pay off the building in case there is just five people showing up. Oh, my goodness sakes. I haven't even gotten through. I've gotten through the first verse, haven't I? This is what I do with God. This is like wild. And this is what I do in the home. It's like, oh, my goodness sakes, I'm having a Pentecostal experience in my living room. Verse number two. For length of days and long life and peace they will add to you. Now, I don't know if you saw it or not. The first verse tells you what to do. The second verse tells you, if you do it, you're going to get blessed. I don't know if you got that. One thing God says about this, listen to this. He doesn't say do this because it pleases him. You do this because you get blessed. God's out to bless you. God's out to bring you into your own promised land. And he makes a statement, for length of days and long life and peace, they will add to you. Now, watch this. They will add to you. Stop, leave it right there in verse number 2. For length of days and for long life and peace, they will add to you. I don't know if you get it or not. Look at it again. For length of days and long life, hey, that's cool. And peace. I tell you what, you live all your life to get those moments of peace. You go on vacation to have peace. Anybody been on a vacation and you didn't have peace and you said, man, I just got robbed? That's like the worst vacation I've ever been on in my entire life. I got to go back to work to rest. Anybody know? You all laugh because you know what I'm talking about. I'm talking about a peace that doesn't come from the motorhome. I'm talking a peace that comes from God. Peace that surpasses all of your understanding. And listen to this, on top of that, long life. But he made this statement, and you missed it right there in the verse. The verse is the word they. See it? They will add to you. They? Who's the they he's talking about? The they is not forgetting and keeping his commandments, verse 1. That simple thing of not forgetting and keeping his command, as simple as that is, will bring you long life in your life, great length of days. In other words, the days won't go by so fast, it'll be absolutely amazing. And then what happens, listen, is not only length of days, but you're going to have peace in the length of days. Didn't say you wouldn't have trouble, trials, tribulation, but peace in those days. Yeah. Let me tell you something. We all work to get money in order to get ourselves in a place that we can have peace. And you know it. And truly, peace doesn't come by what you have in your wallet. Peace comes by what you have in your heart. Are you listening to me? And the peace you're looking for is not going to come from how much you accumulate in your 1031 or your 403BK. It's going to come because they... Two things, you didn't forget where you came from, and you kept his, and you let your heart keep his commandments. Oof. It goes on, it's really quite cool. I would have been happy if he stopped there, but you know, God never just stops. He makes it so plain, he can hardly wait to get all of this into you. He wants to download. You know, every one of us pay money to have fast computers. Faster the better, faster the better, faster. I want to push the button and it's there instantaneously. God would love to download instantaneously into all of us, but it takes time. What takes time with God is good because you won't forget it. And that's very important for all of us. Verse 3 says, let not mercy and truth forsake you. Bind them around your neck. Let's be honest with each other. I have a tattoo. Yeah, you didn't know I had a tattoo, did you? I'm going to show it to you. It's right here on my arm. You thought I was going to do that. You know, you're very bad. When I was like 14 years old, I had a girlfriend named Dana, and her initials were DC. Debbie doesn't even know this, do you, Deb? And, my arm's gotten so white and old, you can't even see the tattoo. I actually took a needle and India ink, and I did DC in here. Do you remember those days when you made your own tattoos? You know, and I actually have, it looks like a fishing hook, that is J. I did J, because I'm right-handed, it was right here. See? That is bound. Anybody in here have a real tattoo? Raise your hand. Okay, come on, raise your hand. Don't be chickens. About... a half of you. The word bind, it says there, is an interesting word. Bind them around your neck. It's like something tattooed on you that wherever you go. And he says two things, mercy and truth. He He says, let not. Here's that let not. Here's that option again. Here's your heart once again in there. Here's something you make happen that you don't let mercy and you don't let truth. Let me ask you a question. Where does truth come from but God? I don't really give a flip what man has to say. You can't really care what men have to say. Men are idiots. Have you ever noticed one side is this way, one side is that way, one is this, one is that? They're extremes. They all have their opinions, and they all think they're right. That's why there's the Democratic Party. That's why there's a Republican Party. That's why there's Fox News and there's CNN. Can I tell you something? No one's right but Jesus. And we have got to find the truth, and we got to tattoo it on our hearts. Kind of interesting. Around our neck and write them on the tablets of our hearts, because this is all about your heart. A lot of people don't understand that. Whatever's going to come out for your future is going to come out from your heart. Did you know that your prayers that come out of your mouth and out of your head don't even work? It's only when I cried out to God from the depth of my heart that my prayers, I had been praying for years before God and speaking the word of God, I'm healed by the stripes of my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, I'm healed by the stripes, and I wasn't getting any better, until it came from my heart, not my head and my mouth. Yeah. It starts with my head and my mouth, but then it's got to drop down into my heart, so it comes out of my heart from my head to my mouth. It can't go from my head to my mouth to my heart. It just starts in the head and the mouth, goes to my heart. When it comes out of my heart, then it changes the world that I live in. The tablets of your heart, very important that you have mercy and truth. Truth is what God says. Mercy is what you give to people who are not as far along in life as you are or you see it. Wonderful. The next verse comes along, verse number 4, and we're speeding right along. And because you do this, verse 4, he's going to give you another promise. And so find favor in high esteem in the sight of God and man. I don't know about you, but I need favor with men, and I need favor with God. I'm 70 years old, and I just started a business. Most of you know I started alternative energy systems and business. I believe in the future, energy is going to be bigger than the internet. And I feel like if God can prosper and allow Bill Gates and Warren Buffett to prosper, he can do more than that with me. And so I've started alternative energy systems. And in the natural, my whole life is at stake at 70 years old. It's easier for me to sit back and let these young pastors who are better than I have ever been preach the word of God and be safe in my last years, comforted. But instead, I believe God to be so big that I'm believing for great things. I believe God wants to change the energy systems of this world. And it's pretty cool. It's a $1 trillion business. And I need, in order for it to happen, it isn't going to happen because I'm smart or been a pastor or could quote scripture or any of that stuff, but it's going to happen because I find favor and high esteem in the sight of God and man. None of you are ever going to do anything until you find favor in high esteem, and high esteem, and high esteem. I should have highlighted the word and the word high esteem, because that goes right along with the word favor, in the sight of God and man. Now let me just talk to you about this. This is the craziest verse in the whole world. You see the word favor up there? Do you see the word favor, yes or no? The word favor up there is the exact same word that's translated most of the time for the word grace in the Old Testament. If you properly translate that, here you see something fascinating. And it says, if you will wrap that mercy and truth and bind it to your heart, something happens. You're going to have find grace, oh, watch this, and high esteem
in the sight of God and man. Wait a minute. That doesn't make sense, God. I'm sitting in my living room talking to him. Grace is unmerited favor. It's a gift from God. I didn't earn it. I didn't do anything to get it. It's a gift from God. And then the Spirit of the Lord spoke to me and said these words, which I found absolutely fascinating. He said, it's a gift from God and you didn't do anything for it, but you have got to find it. And I said, wait a minute. What do you mean find it? Like, is it lost? He says, until you activate it, it's lost. Let me give you an illustration of that. If I gave you $1 billion, anybody want to raise their hand, would like to have the first $1 billion? Oh, no, I'm only kidding you. Just raise your hand if you'd like to have $1 billion. Listen to me. And I didn't tell you what bank it was in, but you got it. It's a free gift to you. It's in your name. I don't tell you where. I don't tell you when. I don't tell you the account. Didn't tell you anything. You had absolutely no ability to access that $1 billion, but it's a gift. It's a gift. But it's not a gift until you can access it. If I receive a gift, let's say someone buys me a $100 Visa card, and you lost it. It fell down in the crack of the seat of the car, and you didn't find it until you cleaned out your car 4 years later. That gift that was given to you didn't do you any good until you got it, went to the store, and put it to work. And what God says here, this grace that God gives you freely must be activated through mercy and truth. Oh my God. In other words, there's a responsibility that I have to activate the grace. That's why he says you can, doesn't he say this, Paul writing? You can frustrate the grace. The grace that you have is given to you, but it doesn't mean it's not without responsibility of activating. And most preachers nowadays are starting to preach that you don't have to do anything. Guess what? What happens when you do nothing? You frustrate the grace and you never activate it, and you're a dead Christian, never doing anything. So he comes along and he says these things, bind them around your neck, hold on to them, hold on to them in your heart, mercy and truth. And he says, then you will find grace. Or the other word for that is favor with man and God in order for your future to be opened up. Is that cool? Is that cool?
Yeah.
It's a great word. Verse number 5. Then he comes along and he makes this statement. He says, trust in the Lord with all of your heart. Notice how trust has got to be something that you don't do just with your mind or thought or your time, but it's got to be, it comes back to the issue of the heart. Trust in the Lord with all of your heart's a whole lot different than anything else that you're ever going to do. Now it becomes a heart expression. And he says these words, and lean not unto your own understanding. We've heard that a million times. It's kind of cool. But leaning means what you're dependent on. And oftentimes we're dependent on so many things. I mean, if we're in financial strait, we would depend on the bank to come through for us or extend our credit. We would depend on our mom or dad loaning us money. We're depending on, if you will, you know, our aunt or uncle. Maybe they're rich and I'll go tell them about what I need and they will help me to get what I need done. But I tell you something, when you have esteem and favor or grace with God, may I say this to you? That means every door is going to be opened up to you. You don't have to wait for the bank or your mom or dad or aunt or uncle or anybody else to come and do something for you because you did not depend on them. He says this next thing. He says, we often are people who depend on something different than God. We depend on our education to get us a promotion. We depend on our ability to get us and keep us the job. We depend on our health in order to express who we are. When your dependence has got to be completely 100%, who are you leaning on all the time? Let me tell you something. His name is Jesus. It has nothing to do with you. That's why when we look at the Word of God and we see it, as I mentioned earlier, David coming in to become king over all of Israel, he could have come in with a flashy robe and said, look at my robe. Look how wonderful I am. As he walks up into Jerusalem, he tears the robe off. His wife is frustrated. You don't act much like a king. You're half naked running up here dancing before the Lord because he's making a statement that God put me in this place because he had esteem, favor with God and man. Because he had mercy, didn't he not, with Saul? And he had what? The truth operating on the inside of his heart. And it all comes from the depths of your heart. It depends on who you're leaning on. Are you leaning on the robe that you have? Are you leaning on who God truly is? Well, I don't know about you, but I need to be a person that's dependent on God all the time. And that's why I keep beating the same drum all the time. That's why I really need church. You know, comes along, makes a statement in verse number 6, which is an interesting word, just pop it up. In all of your ways, acknowledge him. Here's what really tore me up about this verse. We've said it, we know it, we've quoted it, but I want you to listen to me for a moment what God spoke to me last week about it. Notice the word all. In all of your ways, acknowledge him. I have been trying, not very good, but I've been trying in all of my ways to acknowledge God before I open my big mouth. And I have not done a good job about it. I have not done a good job. In all of your ways, whatever your ways are, whatever your issues are, whatever your trial is, the question is, God, here I am. What would you have me to do? That's acknowledging God. What would you have me do? Before I do this little thing, God, what would you have me to do? I know how to do it. I know which way to do it. I know how to respond. I know my own ways of doing things. I know I have my own. I've done this over and over and over and over and over. But he makes this statement in how many ways? All. All of your ways, acknowledge God. So here comes this, again, something for us to do. And it is coupled again with this amazing promise. We don't do that in all of our ways. If we know how to do something, we do it in our own way because we know how to do it. You know it and I do too. And I catch myself at least 10 times a day. When I know I should respond one way, I'm responding a different way. And I did not acknowledge God. It's been so obvious to me. It is a life-changing verse. God, here I am. How would you have me to do it? In my business, I have got to say, God, I absolutely don't know what I'm doing. But if I'm going to do what I'm doing, I know you're the creator that knows how to build energy systems because you're the power of the universe. So show me how to do this. And I don't have a problem in what I don't know how to do to acknowledge God. I have a problem in acknowledging God in what I do know what to do. This verse made me crazy in my living room last week. God says, you know how to acknowledge me when you don't know how to do anything else but ask me for direction. But when you know how to do it yourself and you don't ask me, you don't need me at all. Then you're depending on your own insight, your own wisdom, and your own understanding to get the job done. And I'm going, guilty, guilty, guilty. So all day long, here's how you and I are supposed to be. God, what would you have me to do? God, what would you have me to buy? God, how about this one? What would you have me to say? God, how do you want me to respond? In all of your ways, acknowledge the Lord. I mean, it's just like this simple thing that we've said and quoted. We all know this verse by heart, but here's the problem. We don't acknowledge the Lord in all of our ways. We only acknowledge the Lord in some of our ways. And that's why oftentimes there is a change. Because the next part of this verse 7 comes. Verse number 6. Go back to verse number 6. I'm sorry.
It says this, and he shall direct your path. What could be better than him directing your path?
Come on.
I mean, if he's directing my path, I'm on the right road. Why? Because remember, I started off by telling you he wants my life to be blessed. He says, I want you to follow my commandments because you don't know how to do life. I want you to follow my ways because you don't know any ways but the worldly ways, and they fail. I want you to follow my directions because you don't have any directions except stupid directions from stupid people who don't acknowledge God. And so all of a sudden he comes along and says, acknowledge me in all of your ways, and then I'll give you the blessing if you'll do that. And the blessing is, I'll direct your path. Oh my goodness, if I've got God directing my path, I'm a successful person in every area of my life. And that, by the way, is a promise from God. That's like this promise from God that's amazing. He shall. Not maybe, not hopefully. He shall. But you have to do something before you get the he shall. We got to acknowledge him in some of our ways, a few of our ways, our needy ways, our wanting ways. All of our ways, even that which you know to do. Because can I tell you something? In order to get to the blessed path that you need to be on, you're going to have to do something different than what you've been doing. And what you've been doing is what you know to do instead of what he wants you to do. So he may tell you to go down this path when he says, listen, I don't want to go down that path. It's not familiar to me. I'm uncomfortable with that path. I don't like that path. It feels weird to me. I don't know if I should take that. I'm going to stay where I'm safe. That's the path I like. And God says, no, you're going to stay the same if you go down that path. I'll be with you. Because listen to what he says. He says, direct your path. If he's directing your path, may I tell you this? You're on the right road to the prosperity and blessings that God wants to give to you. Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. Verse number 7 comes along, makes this statement. He says, do not be wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord, depart from evil. So here comes another statement about what to do. Don't be wise in your eyes. Stop being conceited about who you are and what your abilities are. Forget about your abilities. Your abilities can only take you so far. You got to get past your abilities. Get into who God is. This is a God thing. And he says, fear the Lord and depart from evil. In other words, I have such respect from God, I'm departing from evil. Oftentimes, I remember where it was said, let your heart. Guess what? Oftentimes my heart wants to stay in something that I'm familiar with, sin or garbage or trash, instead of getting in it. I have to direct my heart all the time to get into the things of God. I'm just like you. I'm fighting this good fight of faith. Fear the Lord and depart from evil. And then he comes along and makes this statement in verse number 8. Listen to this. He says, and it will be health to your flesh and strength to your bones. Oh my goodness, if you've ever been sick in your life, here it is. Here is the promise from God. He says, do this and you'll get this. And here he comes along and says, I will be health to you. It will be health to you. What will be health? The very fact that you are doing the verse before it, verse 7, pop it back up in verse number 7 for me, John. He says, wise in your eyes, fear the Lord, depart from evil. If you'll just fear the Lord, depart from evil. 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 Fear the Lord, depart from anything contrary to the ways of God. Fear the Lord, respect, reverence, be in fear of who God is, and depart from anything that's contrary to the ways of God. Then he comes along and he says this word, verse 8, here's the promise. And it'll be health to your flesh and strength to your bones. Is that not true? Didn't say you wouldn't get attacked. Can't win. Can't win. Didn't say your bones aren't going to get weak, but guess what? They're going to stay that way. Because I got a promise from God. Is that good news? And verse number 9 and 10 comes along. They're crazy. Just went right along with this morning. Honor. Honor. I love the word honor. I made a note as I was talking to God about the word honor. It's kind of a cool little note. It says this, set him up as the most important. Honor. Is God the most important thing in your life? The person who in the beginning was complaining and criticizing different churches that they had been in was somebody who didn't want God, wanted the church to act like they wanted them to act. But when you set God up to be the most important thing in your life, that's honor. Not the president. You know, if the president walked in here, we'd all stand up, salute, do all that kind of stuff. I would back off, give him the microphone for about 2 seconds, and then I'd have him sit down. No, I'm kidding. I'd be respectful. The president of the United States, be respectful. You'd all be respectful, and you know it. Why? Because he's very important. But God is the one who's honored as the most important, the highest of all the highs of everything, 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 every person, everything, every job, every hour, everything, all that you do, everything. God is more important. Everything, everything, everything. God is more. That's honor. Honor the Lord. And then he comes along and didn't say just with your heart, but he says, put your money where your mouth is. And I don't mean to push on this a lot, but it's very important. Debbie and I never started getting anywhere until we got off of ourselves and got off our finances and realized that the finances belong to God. He'll take care of me. My job is to show God and to be a person that honors him, puts him first. If you do not, let me tell you something. It's kind of funny. Notice how it says with your possessions. Now listen to this. Did you know I'm going to tell you the name of the person who's the largest giver in the church? I hesitate in doing that. The name of the largest giver in the church is a person named Loose Cash. You've heard of Jimmy Cash, haven't you? This must be his brother called Loose Cash. In other words, the biggest gift that comes to this church is what people have in their pocket instead of from what people have in their heart. And they haven't dealt with honor, putting God above their wallet. You say, well, Pastor, preachers just say that so they can be rich. I'm already rich. I don't see your money, touch your money, taste your money. Don't even count your money. Could care less. I'm an old man trying to tell you what God says to help you get into a position of blessing. You're going to have to put God first. He is above everything else. He is the most important of everything. And honor the Lord with what you have. And if you don't honor the Lord with what you have, then you honor the Lord with loose cash, and that's just a token. The word tithe is a funny word. Do you ever wonder why God just said a mount tithe? 10%. The word tithe in the Old Testament, and even in the New Testament, when Jesus was talking about it, Jesus does talk about it a number of times, the word is 10%. That's what the word tithe means. T-I-T-H means this word, 10%. You know why? Because there was a lot of loose cashes in those days. And they would just give and be satisfied with what they could give out of their pocket instead of giving from their heart. So God says, let's make it a heart thing by putting some pressure on you to bring it up to where it should be. So from the first fruit, it was 10%. Man, here comes tithe. Not loose cash, tithe. And of course you start with loose cash. You have to start somewhere, but you gotta have the heart to build back up to where it wants you to be. And God, can I just say this? Someone throws this at me at the door not too long ago. It says, yeah, but the New Testament says that man should give according to the purpose in his heart. But did you know what the New Testament requires? All of your heart. Yeah. Not 10%. You're gonna stone me? No, because here's what it says. When you put God in the right place and you respect him and elevate him above everything, everything, everything else, you honor the Lord with what you have, and that what you have ought to start somewhere. And if you go broke, here's what you do. Tell it to God. He'll take care of you, because remember what he says is a promise is that go with it. He says, and the first fruit of all of your increase. Verse number 10, it says, what for? I love what Pastor Dan said today. Your barns. Not mine, not the churches. It would be great if the church, everybody tithe. It's crazy that we're not doing that. Because you know why we don't do it? Because we really don't honor. We're really afraid. He's not as important as our fears. And you know it and I know it. So let's be honest with each other. There's no other way you're going to change, nor am I going to change, unless somebody tells me the truth. If you don't want the truth, then go back to smoking incense. You're here tonight because you want the truth. You don't want the smoke and incense. Don't play games of religious stuff with me. Tell me what God really wants. Here's what God really wants. I want you to have such a heart for him that you honor him with all of your possessions, and therefore he can bless you. And that's what we started off from the very beginning. God really wants for you to bless you. That your barns, this is just an illustration, but your house, your home, your business, finance, dream, vision, your children, everything that you have is, listen, filled with plenty. That you can just walk up to somebody and you hear something, and you know something, God speaks to you, you take out your checkbook and write a check for $10,000. You don't even feel it. Don't even feel it. Could care less. That's plenty. He says this, and your vats overflow with new wine. Why does he use new wine? Because new wine is so expansive. It grows and it builds and it spills over, and you'll have so much new wine that becomes the great wine, that becomes the best tasting wine, that it'll have to expand, but your vats can't even hold it. All back to blessing you again. I love you guys. I'm an old man. I've lived this all my life. I'm a memorial, a living testimony of the truth of the Word of God, that it absolutely, totally, and completely works. And those verses, 10 little verses. Next time we get together, could I do 10 more? You're going to have to watch, because I don't know if I'm going to be in Wednesday night or Sunday night. I guarantee I'm not doing the Sunday mornings, because I don't want to do that many services. Let the young guys do that stuff. And but I like Sunday night every now and then, Wednesday night every now and then. Thank you so much for hearing me today tell you, as God speaks, what his word is saying to us all. Isn't it a great word? Isn't God good? Wasn't it worth coming to church for? Come on now. You know it's true. Some of you need to get right with God today. But the Bible says, tell me if this is not true, Dr. Kobernick and Dr. Becker and all of the rest of you that are in here, Reverend, that you're saved by grace through faith. Is that right? Has anyone ever heard that? Saved by grace through faith. So the very faith that you have activates the grace that's given to you. Isn't that cool? And so in order to activate the faith, because faith without works is dead, you're going to have to do something about the grace that's been given to you for salvation. Is that not right? And you have to do this. Jesus said, you must be born again. Comes to a guy in John 3rd chapter, a guy by the name of Nicodemus. Nicodemus is a great guy. Now think about who Nicodemus is. Nicodemus, I mean, he's probably better in his lifestyle than all of us. He's a keeper of the law, memorizes scripture, quotes scripture, debates scripture, sings the scripture. How many of you could sing the scripture? Oh my goodness, I couldn't even sing the scripture. I can't sing anything. He sang the scripture, fed the poor in his community, wore ecclesiastical robes. This guy was highly educated and very successful. He comes to Jesus. He says, what must I do to enter into heaven? He was smart as a whip. And he asked that question because he knew this guy had the answers. His name is Jesus. Jesus says to him, you must be born again. But most people don't understand what born again means. Born again means you're going to activate the grace that's been given to you through the faith that you have by doing something with your life. Huh? And from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, what in the world is God after? But all of your heart and all of your life. All of your heart, not a part of it, and all of your life. And if you haven't given God all of your heart and you haven't given God all of your life, then you're wasting your time and my time and God's time until you do that commitment. See, this is not head knowledge that gets you into heaven. See, most Americans think they're going to heaven because someone told them, do you believe in Jesus? Well, yes, the cool thing to do is to say yes to that. We're Americans. Well, if you believe in Jesus, then you're going to heaven. Uh-huh. Well, so do you think the devil doesn't believe in Jesus? He's not going to heaven. You think demons don't believe in Jesus? They came to him and said, please, before our time, don't send us to hell. They believed in Jesus too. They're not going to heaven. It's not what you have in your head. It's what you've done with your heart. Now, stop and think about it just for a second. If that's true, and it is, then for some of you, haven't given God all of your heart, and you haven't given God all of your life. What we taught tonight, where God says, my son, intimate relationship on his part, can only be filled as an intimate relationship as you take the position as the son. Take the position as his child. Take the position that he's your father. And the only way that works is you have to give God all of your heart, all of your life, and activate the grace that's been given to you on that cross at Calvary. Wow. So tonight, here we are in the house of God. Safe, we've laughed. Man, you were great listening to the Word of God. I don't think I lost maybe four or five of you that fell asleep for just a short while, but then you woke back up. I was happy about that. It wasn't the front row. They were wide awake. You were great. But it won't get you to heaven. Coming to church tonight won't get you to heaven unless you activate the grace that's in the house by giving God all of your heart in faith and giving God all of your life. It's that simple. It's that simple. Can I just say this one more thing? Somebody needs to love you enough and respect you enough and honor you enough to stop playing church and tell you the truth. And I sit before you tonight and tell you, I love you and respect you enough to tell you the truth. You got to give God all of your heart and give God all of your life. I loved it in third service today. Dan gave two altar calls, one in the beginning. And you thought everybody got saved in the whole building. Then God said, you got a few more minutes. Give him another altar call, third service. He filled up the altar again in front. It's like this place is a baby factory. And you know it's time for you to give God all of your heart and give God all of your life. You haven't done that. You know who he is in your head. You celebrate Christmas. You celebrate Easter. You know who he is. But you haven't given him all of your heart, activated the grace, and you haven't given him all of your life. And he's not going to steal it from you or connive you out of it, hit you in the head with a 2x4. No, he isn't going to do that. But you've got to do your part, giving God all of your heart and giving God all of your life. Tonight, it's your night of salvation. You say, well, Pastor Jim, how do we do it? Let's do it God's way. Jesus said, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father. But if you deny me, I'll deny you. So in a moment, I'm going to count three. I'll go like this. 1, 2, 3, and I'll pop my hands together. Bang! And you hear that sound. Bang! Your hand goes up. I'll see your hand go up. You put it right back down. That simple. What you're saying is I acknowledge what I'm hearing, and I want to get right with God, and I don't want to go to hell. And I want to give God all my heart, and I want to give God all my life, and I want to be born again, headed for heaven, and denying my presence now. I'll see your hand go up. What did he say? If you confess me where? Before men, I'm a man, I'll see it. I'll confess you as mine before my Father. And you want that. Tonight is your night of salvation. Who should raise their hand if you've been running from God? Instead of to God, I'm speaking to you. If you've never given him all of your heart, never given him all of your life, I'm speaking to you. If you're one of those people that are not sure, maybe you always thought of yourself as a Christian, went to church forever. Maybe you were a leader in your last church, but that won't get you to heaven. You must be born again. Don't care if you finished seminary and pastored for 20 years. Can I tell you something? That won't get you to heaven either. It's about the heart. You've got to give God all of your heart, give God all of your life, be born again, headed for heaven, denying your presence in hell. All across this auditorium, I'm talking to you, and you know who you are. God's watching you right now. Today is your day, a divine appointment you have with God to give God all of your heart, give God all of your life. I'm going to count to three. Bang! I'm going to pop my hands together just like that. Bang! When you hear that sound, you get your hand up. Let me see it. Put it right back down. It's as simple as that. You say, wait a minute. If I raise my hand, I'll be embarrassed. Yep, you will be. Get over it. It's better to be embarrassed in a safe place like this than to be in hell forever and ever and ever and ever and ever and ever and ever. My goodness, and there's no choices in hell. You know, you get in hell, you'd raise anything to get out, but you can't, then it's over with. But today you have a choice. Sit there and do nothing, or give God all of your heart, give God all of your life. All across this auditorium, I'm going to speak to you right now, and I want you to count to three, pop my hands, you get your hand up. Even in the family rooms, I see you're in the family rooms. Let me check you out right now. He says, if you confess me before men, I'm a man, I'll see you. Here it is, I'm counting to three. Ready? Are you ready? One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Let me see your hands. There's one. Thank you. There's two, three, four. Thank you. Back over here. Thank you. Anybody else? Real quick, let me see your hands. There's four wise people. I see it. Five, six. Thank you. Anybody else? Anybody else? There's five or six wise people. Anybody else? Thank you. Right over here, there's you say there's another one over here? Seven? I got you, man. Got you. Good for you. Good. Where are you? There's another one over here you're pointing at somewhere over here? Over here. Did I already count them? Did I already count them? No, I did, didn't I? Okay, I think I did. Yeah, I think I did. Like six or seven. Anybody else real quick? Need to give their heart and life to Jesus? Don't miss this. Don't miss it. Don't miss it. Don't miss it. Let's give the Lord a great big praise for five or six people. Praise God. Here's what I want you to do. All five or six of you, raise your hand. You're serious about God. Why don't you get a holy coat, purse, sweater, Bible, friend. Get your stuff. If you're serious about God, get your stuff. And you know, if you're in the middle of the aisle, they'll let you out. It's not like you're in a movie theater and knock over their popcorn. Get in the aisle, come down here in front. We'll all stand and wait for you. We're excited about you making this choice in your life. This is the best moment of your entire existence. And so get out of your seat, get your stuff, bring a friend if you need to get a friend. Meet me right here in front. You come right now. If you didn't raise your hand, but you should have, you can come too. Come now, come, 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 come.
I'm not going back, I'm moving ahead. Here to declare.
Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on.
My past is
over. You come too, come, come.
All things are made new. Surrendered my life to Christ.
Come on, you come too, come on, come on.
I'm moving, I'm not going back. I'm moving ahead. I'm here to declare to you. My past is over.
Anybody else? Anybody else needs to come fast? Hurry.
Surrender my life to
Well, thank God you guys have come. Put a big smile on your face. This is a good thing, not a bad thing. You're not going to the morgue. You're going to heaven. So this is a good time, okay? I want you to look to your left. This is Pastor Joel Alvarado, my friend. He's going to give you some free information, but first he's going to lead you in a prayer. He'll tell you what to do. He's a really good guy. Just follow him right over there. Make a left turn and follow Joel Alvarado right over there. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise. Will you do that? Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me. And then he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven, as well as upon the earth, that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.